Welcome to Bible Study, because we are talking about the gospel that is berserk. Today we got Judah. Is Judah a simp? Well, I don't know. This is a hard one. Yes, he sat through Griffith completely ignoring Casca. Shit, he may have even realized that the baby Hulk was trying to make Hulk Juniors. But at the end of the day, it's hard to classify Judah as a simp, because a confession within the messy relationship dynamics we've seen in The Man and the Hulk, let alone the series, would have put the series and the characters in an awkward spot. I don't think what possibly classifies Judah as a simp is what he did, because all of his major actions really would have been reciprocated by Casca, but it's the inaction that makes him a simp in multiple's eyes. I clearly don't think he's a simp, because a simp in his most basic form is doing something for someone who would not do the same things back. But I know the dude, you are going to do most of the work during the very early stages, but simping is doing way too much. Someone who compromises their character in hopes of getting validation from another. Someone who goes the extra mile for a person who wouldn't even take a step. Someone who falls in love, because you shouldn't be getting caught slipping anyway. Like, get up, my nigga. I'd rather your little dumbass jump in love, rather than fall. Get yourself together. I put emphasis on fall because that tells me that you are doing something you have no business doing, because you obviously weren't ready for it. You don't fall when you know what's coming. Tells me that you were not watching your step, doing everything but your due diligence. It's okay to be in love, but falling is crazy. If you fall, you better play it off and do some push-ups, bruh. Like, think about it. Every clumsy klutz you have ever seen on TV has been a simp. All of that's to say that Judah wasn't really a simp. He was just realistic. He was up against an individual who reminded grannies what it meant to be young again, and a guy who asks for your moms whenever he sees you. Life is unfair, uttered the blonde boy. And I'm personally going to show you how it was unfair for Judah, and how he needs justice. In the criminal justice system, the people are represented by two separate yet equally important groups: the police who investigate the crime, and the district attorneys who prosecute the offenders. These are the stories. Exhibit A, rescuing Casca. My guy Judah pulls up and saves the day while Casca is battling a couple of foreign goons. I know he felt like that guy when he came to save the day. For his act of bravery, he was expecting some sort of praise from her. Then to be met with this. This meant two things for Judah: that something had developed between Guts and Casca, and that the line to Casca's heart just got longer, with Guts forcing himself in front of him. All of this is realized by the cunning boy in one short panel that doesn't have too much meaning during your first read, but makes absolute sense when rereading, knowing Judo's feelings for Casca. Judo's character is great, because he isn't a jealous guy at all, he's just realistic. But he felt heartbreak at this moment. Damn, she don't even seem to care I pulled up. Was she crying about the next nigga? That is what his face reads. The embodiment of a Bart Simpson sad meme. Then they arrive to save Guts, but Guts proves that this was indeed a boss battle. But for the enemy, Judo saved the day, just to show Casca that Guts is a demigod. Judah was sweating under the heartbreaking pressure of seeing the girl of his dreams, completely consumed by the god that he thought was no competition. Just a couple days before, they hated each other's guts. But now things were so passionate, caring, and affectionate, like two wild wolves licking each other's wounds. As the saying goes, she hates my guts, but I be in hers. It's a little too true here. This panel is great because it shows how messy of a situation this is. The guys in the back are sweating because they may have lost their leader, but the one in the front is sweating because he may have lost his love. Yes, Judo was happy to see Guts alive because he isn't a jealous person and he actually wants Guts to be alive, but he doesn't want Casca to be this happy. I always said in Berserk, the eyes tell the whole story. Kentaro Miura is a master of conveying emotion, intent, and feelings through the minute details in his creation's eyes. Casca's eyes show absolute joy, exhilarating elation, and a sigh of relief in pure euphoria. And Judo's eyes show despair. The eyes are the windows to the soul, and his soul has left his body. His eyes demonstrate shock, anger, confusion, betrayal, defeat, and ultimately extreme sadness to the brink of tears. This is the look you make when the girl of your dreams tells you that your friend is cute, a form of hurt that you cannot express because it will make things even more convoluted and messy. But a form of betrayal that cannot be described nor justified because you never express your feelings. Again, Judo's curse of inaction puts him in situations that were agonizing and unavoidable. When you try to impress, but you are stacked up against men who are impressive, you will always lose. Maybe I guess this is a lesson to all you young kings out there. Don't impress. Be impressive.
Who spends hundreds of dollars?
See, this
you
is the thing.
You have to set the bar.
And this is advice I tell the children, right? Don't try to impress the bitch. Don't try to impress. Just be impressive.
Exhibit B, Elf Dust. We all know this crack in a bag is something stupendously different. shit really saves lives. Probably something vital to a mercenary, you know, like something you shouldn't give away. And he gives it to Guts. He is the type of kid who gives his pencil away when he only has one pencil. But he gives it to Guts for multiple reasons though. Out of the kindness of his heart, he cares for Guts. He knows Guts is vital to the band at the Hawk. And he knows that Casca would appreciate it. In other words, he knows it would benefit him to keep Guts healthy and to be the knight in shining armor when the real knight in shining armor is in a sunken place. But it shows how generally good of a guy he is. Judo also lets Casca know that despite Griffith's absence, he was extremely considerate of them and held them to extremely high regard, telling her that Griffith said, "Those two are vital to the band of the Hawk. I will not lose them." Though it was probably to his own detriment, putting Griffith in a better light to comfort Casca and giving Guts the fairy dust, he truly just wants to see Casca smile. Good people tend to suffer the most. They are romantics bound to a set of morals and values that they can never deviate from, with every action and decision coming from a place of true character. Instead of fearing disappointment from the ones around them, they more so fear disappointing themselves, living with themselves after doing something deviant from their moral compass. And with Casca's spirits being uplifted, so was his. Then Kintar did this nigga ugly and let his eyeball do his own thing. He did his ass filthy, bruh. Why he do this nigga like that? The plot did that nigga filthy, and the art did that nigga filthy. That's tough. Exhibit C, The Departure. Judo is a man you can listen to for hours. He draws in your attention, but also avoids saying extravagantly flowery terms. He only speaks when he has something to say, each word teasing you and leading you on to the end of each sentence. Judo is realistic with himself, stating that he is a jack of all trades, but comes to terms that he is a master of none. He is but a thought, not a dream. The dream motif is an essential plot device in the series, because it allows us to see what drives the burning desires of the band the Hawk within the much larger inferno of Griffith's ambition. Chapter 34 is a great chapter, because it does two main things. It tells us what Corcus's dream is, and insinuates what Judo's dream is. On the surface, Judo looks to be satisfied standing among the greats. So to a non-discerning eye, he looks to have attained his dream and is in a comfortable place with the glory of the band of the Hawk. But judging by his somber and gloomy demeanor, he doesn't give the aura of a man who has conquered his life. He seems to be a slave to his dreams like everyone else. Judo aligns himself with Griffith, who excels in every area that Judo lacks, which is all areas. From sword skills, wits, and good looks, to status and charm, Judo wanted to be the best at something. Hell, I would even say that this changed to a need to be the best at something. For someone. For Griffith, Casca was his sword. For Guts, Casca was his medicine. And for Judo, Casca was his drive. The thing he chased, win or lose until the better end. Exhibit D, Saving Griffith. The two guys that his love interest is enamored with fight. The one she worships loses, and the one she recently developed a deep connection with leaves in hopes of becoming an equal to one she worships. To put it simply, it's a mess. And Judo is caught in a mess of things. Because he truly wants to see Casca happy, he starts to fill a void that is left as a result from Guts' absence. Though we don't get a lot of info on this newfound relationship between Casca and Judo, we can assume that they become rather close, but not in the way that Judo wanted. I would hop right to it, but it makes much more sense if I look at the timeline of events. After the battle that left the Hawk wingless, the battle that catalyzed the fall of the band the Hawk, the inception of the much larger inferno that consumes the much smaller campfire of dreams, Griffith, losing a crucial stepping stone towards his dream, decides to forcibly lay an imitation. If our military prowess dwindles, then I shall force my social status to the point of monarch. He sleeps with Charlotte, gets caught, and is sentenced to the dungeon for treason, where he is tortured by a figure that was probably tortured by society itself. The creepy king can't let go of the fact that his precious princess has been deflowered, so he sets his sights not only on the extermination of Griffith, but furthermore his dream. The king sets the band of the Hawk up with a volley of arrows. Casca takes charge and they miraculously escape. This is where Judo steps up and becomes Casca's right-hand man, which is a great place to be if you have zero romantic intentions, but a horrible place to be if you are madly in love. The power dynamic is off, and the chance of this escalating to a point favorable to our blonde, jinxed soul is close to zero. He's in a spot worse than the friend zone. He is a subordinate, a goon, a minion, a henchman, an underling, an aide, or a lackey. I am not trying to paint the picture that Judo's lame, but he isn't extraordinary. He is extraordinary. Don't get me wrong. In the absence of Guts and Griffy, he held some weight and is pretty cool. But he is up against guys who have nicknames. Guys who have attained Corcus's dream by default. They are somebodies. The Hawk and the Black Swordsman. The Dreamer and the Struggler. The Ambitious and the Vengeful. a love triangle that he can't fit in, because three is a crowd and the competition should have gotten patched in Human Evolution Update 9. If this was SEL, these niggas is beaters. We're gonna do a little bit of time skipping to end up at a scene that is all too similar to the scene when Gus was saved after slaying 100 men. Though this scene is way too tragic to make jokes about, Buddy was standing on top of a stick and talking shit as if he had the immunity of being in the safety of his home. The nigga looked like an abyssal creature, a fifth layer raid boss. Always instead of best. Everything born from the abyss is destined to find its way back. This of course leads to a chain of very unfortunate events for the band, and really opportune ones for Griffith. The man who could no longer chase his dreams. The hawk, snipped of his wings. The man who seemingly had his inferno, quenched by the predatorial spit of a twisted and demented king. But with the influence of the deepest, darkest depths of the astral world, causality intervenes. Now let's skip to Exhibit F, the feast. Cause we're gonna be typing the F in chat for this one. Though this one's going to be less about how life is unfair for Judo, and more about how life is over, it's still really relevant. We put so much emphasis on final words. It's treated with the utmost respect, because in many ways it's immortal while the individual isn't. In superficial ways, the lasting memory of you is just as important as you. Life is too short to dissect, and that's why I believe that the last impression, the legacy, is so important. It's not the spreads of perfume, but the aroma that envelops the room. It's not the nuclear bomb, but the fallout. Life is nuclear, so be radioactive. But with Judo's curse of inaction, even his legacy was lacking, defective, lousy, inadequate, and disappointing. His life almost amounted to a sneeze you can't sneeze, a Donkey Kong wind-up with no punch, a Lucario charge with no blast, self-pleasure with no climax or lux, getting killed mid-alt. The inability to confess is something that can haunt a man, because one could be driven to complete and utter insanity, creating and dwelling on the hypothetical scenarios in their head about what could have been while living in denial of how it turned out to be. But with the confession, you can rest assured that the life you are living is the life you created, a life you forced in a direction you controlled. Yes, the other person has the power to say yes or no, but you presented the question. When I started taking full responsibility for my outcomes, either being my life, living situation, performance in any area, or mental health, I was initially scared shitless into a state of inaction. What should I do today? Why would I waste precious time I would never get back by doing this? What opportunity am I missing out on that I would regret not knowing about in the future? It led to me stretching myself too thin and losing focus on what I truly wanted. Then I started seeing life as more of a game that can be controlled to some large degree by your drive to learn how to play this game, how to enjoy this game. I started analyzing myself and figured out some ugly truths about myself and why I was the way I was. I realized how deadly inaction was and how powerful action is, where your actions lead to a consequence, where your cause created the effect. Judo's inaction makes sense, because it almost made too much sense for him to not act on his desires. It would cause a very uncomfortable rift in the band to Hawk, and be a hindrance to Cassidy's duties to the one she practically worshipped, quite possibly endangering the Hawk and his ambitions with a dull sword. I am all talk, after all. No, Judo, you weren't. Though he never got to say what he wanted, his actions speak for themselves. Even though he never said it, he demonstrates time and time again his love and affection for Casca. From the rescue headed by him during the Tudor conflict, to the elf dust and the relaying of the kind and comforting words from Griffith. With Judo's last words being, you sure do cry a lot, you know, but his last thought being, although personally, I always thought I was a bit smoother than that. I want to stop him there and congratulate him. You stayed calm and collected even when things were over for you. Not a blonde-haired boy, but a man who was always thinking about his team, but never himself. Yes, he did himself a disservice by never telling her, but telling her then would have been cruel. Judo, the jack of all trades, master of none. No, Judo, jack of all trades, and master of restraint. Yes, Judo suffered from the curse of inaction, but at least he can die knowing that the actions he did take were noble ones. He is a very interesting character that needed a backstory. We needed a flashback of his life before the band of the Hawk and the events that led him there, to a band of broken souls with a dark past, invigorated by the light of the cunning and treacherous White Hawk. Judo had a heart made full metal, and considering the circumstances, he cannot be called a simp at all. However, don't get me wrong, don't be like Judo. His inaction is justified, but yours is not. Trust me, it's never that scary nor that serious to put yourself out there. just throw yourself into the fire and worry about the repercussions later. Gino's a cold character, and seeing that shit happen was sad as hell because I did not see it coming. Like a lot of things Berserk, that's why I say Berserk is gospel. Berserk is the Bible. It does shit that I've never seen any other series do, and stories were made based off of it. Just so many stories inspired by Berserk, with so much of our fiction that we enjoy today being based on the real Bible, it's really cold to compare the Bible to Berserk. But back to our point of focus, is Judo a simp? Hell no. He's a cold character, and he's a real ass nigga. Another Berserk video is coming soon, and hey, I'ma throw a little bit of a hint out there. Anime questions. Just keep it a beam, yes sirski. But anyway, I appreciate you niggas for watching. Kissing the left cheek, slapping the right. I'll see y'all when I see y'all, man.